was upon the face of the deep. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, and it was good.
Like the rapture, the 7-year tribulation period, the judgment seat of Christ, the second coming of Christ, Armageddon, the seals, the bowls, the plagues, the Antichrist, the beast, and the great white throne judgment. There's so much, and it's very hard to study, learn, preach, and apply. But if we are, you, me, prayed up, if we have asked for godly wisdom and knowledge, if we have been willing to ask others to come and learn, if we want to move forward and grow deeper with Jesus Christ, then God will bless us. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, amen?
Amen.
Revelations chapter 1, verse 3, at the very beginning says this, and I want you to hear this. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take it to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. Let's go to God and seek His face and also seek His blessings as we endeavor to learn and apply these perfect truths. Let's pray together. God, with every head bowed and all eyes closed, we come to You. We are humble this morning, for we are stepping into things which only You know. Enlighten us, O God. Give us discernment to understand what is right and wrong. Let us look at these pages, Your words, the next 3 or 4 weeks, and take them to heart. And if we take them to heart, oh God, then guess what? This house will be overflowing with people because we have been concerned about those that we care about, those that we work with, those that we go to school with, even our neighbors. Father, You teach us. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's children said,
amen.
Throughout the study of the next 3 or 4 weeks, we're going to be in many different books. We're going to see God's truth through the book of Daniel, 1 Corinthians, Revelations, 1 Thessalonians, Ezekiel, Timothy, Matthew, more and more. I even put a piece of paper in the middle of your bulletin for you for notes. On the back of your bulletin is going to be the fill in blanks. But folks, there's going to be some stuff that I'm going to say, it's not going to be on the screen. I can't put it all on the screen. If I did, we'd be here for 17 hours every day, and I don't think that's what's going to hold your attention. So I'm asking you to be students of the Word. Be explorers of the Bible this morning. Be yearners for the truth. Gosh. So let's see what God wants us to learn this morning about the rapture. We're going to really heavily look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through 18. And it says this. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in Him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. Grab this. For the Lord Himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and who are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And may God add His blessing to the reading of this passage of His precious word and the many more that we will see today. When we look at this, we need to very first define what rapture is. So get your pens out, start writing. Here's what rapture really is. It is when Jesus comes back to the clouds and takes His church to heaven. Rapture means to carry off or to catch up. Now, as we look at this, you are going to have to want it in order to grasp it. I can take you only so far. God can take you only so far. If you're willing to be willing to study and to learn, then you're going to get this. So the rapture is when Jesus comes back into the clouds. And the church, okay, let me ask you a question. Out loud, what's the church? The people of Jesus Christ. Is the church this building? Is the church the cathedral building, in XYZ city? Absolutely not. It is the people. So, the rapture is Jesus coming back into the clouds, and He takes us, those who have Jesus in their heart, immediately. So when we think about that, and we use that as a starting point, one of the things I want to lay at your feet, and you might get a little upset right now with me, but you're going to understand after I finish my statement. Number one, I don't want hearsay to be your foundational building blocks. I want Scripture to be your foundational building blocks. I want you to put away your very own thoughts or ideas about the end times and push yourself to Scripture. Everybody say Scripture.
Scripture.
Everything that we go through these three or four sermons will be scripturally based. That's why I want you to make notes. Now, and I'm not saying all teaching is incorrect, but if when you were young, your pastor told you something about the rapture or the tribulation period or the great white throne judgment, and you've never found it in Scripture, I want you to set it aside. I want you to base what you're going to believe in the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
I want you to understand it. If you have never marked in your Bible, these next 3 or 4 weeks might be a good time for you to start marking. Guess what? God won't get mad at you for marking in your Bible. He'll think it's pretty cool. So, what I'm saying to you is, I want you to rethink what you know. Relearn what God wants you to understand and base everything on that. So, in my belief is all about Scripture and how God applies it to us. Here's the thing. God's Word is truth. Everybody say that.
God's Word is truth.
Okay, 2 Timothy says this. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Pastor Mark, why would you want to bring that out when we're going to be talking about the end times? Folks, if we're basing everything on Scripture and not hearsay, on Scripture and not what your mom and daddy's told you, on Scripture and not what your grandpa and mama told you, because you've never found it in Scripture, then guess what? Rethink what you know. And learn what God wants you to learn. Amen. And if our very first point is that God's Word is truth, then we have a genuine, concrete-based foundational system. That's why I had to go there. I also believe that God's Word is absolute. Absolute. You know, my father was a smart man. My mom, good woman. But everything that they told me after I got to be an adult and understanding, a lot of it was tinged with the bias of how they grew up and where they grew up from. And when my father was not a religious man and I found Jesus, the ways of understanding started to separate. So when we say that God's Word is absolute, everybody say God's Word is absolute.
God's Word is absolute.
Here's what I mean. Absolute definition. Perfect, complete, whole, pure. Write it down. Now I'm going to tell you something. Next week I'd like to have everybody here with a pencil. And I want you to take notes. I thought we could do that this week. You need to be taking notes. You need to be understanding this. So, if we know that absolute means perfect, complete, whole, and pure, and we can see that God's Word is perfect, complete, whole, and pure, then we can put things together on top of that. We can build upon that. And since God cannot make a mistake because He is perfect, complete, whole, and pure, we can surmise then that His Word, this Bible that we're going to base everything on, is complete, perfect, whole, and pure. So my point is that we must use this perfect extension of God as the reference for our study on the end times. Now, please understand something. Look at me. Doesn't mean that you can't go to a commentary, a Bible reference material. I'm going to. I have. I'm going to quote other pastors all through this whole thing. These are men that have gone, men and women that have gone much deeper than I in this. And I trust them because they are men and women of God. But before I quote them, I must go back to God's Word and make sure that it's right and complete and whole and pure. So that's what we're saying. So not hearsay, folks. Scripture. 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 Right? So, the number one question that I get is not what happens during the rapture. It's when's it going to happen, Pastor Mark? I find that funny. Because they come and ask me that. I know I'm a pastor and I'm your pastor, but you're going to see I'm not the shell answer man. Okay? I'm not the guy who can tell you everything in that Bible, but I will tell you this. I'll go into it. We had Bible study on Thursday night. Had a great Bible study, I thought. Rock solid. We were rocking. And Becky Vandergriff asked me a question. And at first I thought, you know, I can just shimmy and shake like some of them West Virginia receivers do and get right around there. And I said, that's not me. I said, I don't know the answer, but I'll find it for you, and I'll bring it back to you. That's what we'll do. I hope you come up with a whole bunch of questions. I hope you get ready. And one of them's going to be, when will the rapture occur? No one knows except God. Absolutely, no one knows except God. Here's what I also find funny. There's been, over the course of history, and especially over the past 50 years, there's been at least two pastors that have staked their reputation on their knowledge when Jesus was coming back. One of them got up into his tower on his college campus and said, it's this day, this hour, and I'm going to wait. Well, that day, that hour came, and he's there waiting, and he lost all credibility in the religious community. I don't know when it's going to happen. And neither do you. How can we surmise that? Matthew 24. But about that day, an hour, no one knows. I don't know about you. That's pretty straightforward. Not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, But only the Father. Everybody say, only the Father.
Only the Father.
As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be with the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken, the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. So when you see this, the example is just so blatantly obvious. Those that were there during the time of Noah, they watched a wild, crazy man build a boat that they'd never even seen before. And it was humongous. And they went up to him and said, Noah, what's happening? He said, it's going to rain. Well, for us, that's okay. We can understand that. For them, it's never rained before. And they went ahead and kept doing what they were doing. And when the flood started, the doors were shut. Can you imagine the pounding on the outer hull of that ship? The same thing is going to happen the day of the Lord. There'll be two men working in the field. One will still be there, and the other's going to be gone. The two other guys grinding. Or let's put it in today's terms. You'll be at the plant, and you'll be working with 10 other guys, and all of a sudden, six of them are gone. You'll be in school, and you'll be in a classroom. 24 other people, right? 12 of them, all of a sudden, gone. Just like that. Immediate. Immediate. This is what I'm trying to get you to see. That no one knows the time that it's going to happen. Now, take a breath. Because I have to teach you something that many of you might not have ever heard. There are three major theories in terms of when the rapture will occur in the timeline of the end times. The three are in your bulletin. They are the pre-tribulation theory, the middle tribulation theory, and the post-tribulation period theory. And what this is, to get it all lined out, is the pre-trib is rapture before the tribulation period. Now, I'm going to take a step ahead to next week. For you that know it, hang in there. For you that don't, here's what's happening. In my belief, and I am a pre-tribulationist, in my belief, the rapture will be the first thing to happen in the end times. After Jesus has come into the clouds and has taken the church away, all those, we'll talk about it in detail in a second, then there will be a seven-year period of tribulation. That seven-year period are for all of those that are still left. And that seven-year period is broken into two three-and-a-half-year segments. The first portion of the first three-and-a-half-year segment is going to be bad. But the second three-and-a-half-year segment is going to be hell on earth. It's going to be horrible. Now, why did I put these three right now? The question is, when will the rapture happen? Pre-tribulationists believe that the rapture will happen before the tribulation period, before the second coming of Christ, before the battle of Armageddon, before the judgment seat of Christ, before the great white throne judgment. Here is another theory. The middle tribulationists believe that there will be a seven-year period. Everybody's believing the seven-year period. And the seven-year period is not a man's calendar seven-year period. It is God's seven-year period. So as the tribulation period begins, the middle tribulationist believes that halfway through the tribulation period, before the final section of 3.5 years of hell on earth, the rapture will occur. And those who are in Christ will be gone and not have to deal with this horrible time frame. Now, the post-tribulationists believe, and might I say this for you, One of my mentors in my seminary and also in a lot of my early church leadership was a man that God put in front of me, and he said, choose him. And the reason I chose him, God had me choose him, is because his beliefs were definitely different than mine. All across the board. In fact, he is the only hardcore, are you ready? Post-tribulationist that I know. Post-tribulationists believe that we are right now in the tribulation period. That we're in it. And that the rapture of his church will occur at the end of the 7-year period when God puts that date down. So, he believes, and they believe, that we are in this tribulation period. Now, I don't believe that, but you might. Only thing I'm telling you is I want you not to believe like Pastor Mark believes, because Pastor Mark believes this. I want you to believe it as you add these things together as we go over the next 3 or 4 weeks. It is your building blocks. It is your time frame. It is your joy to challenge what you think or rejoice in what you know. So we've got those three things. But I also add to it 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a what? While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. We do not know the day or the time. It's not here. We don't know that. But I will tell you this. There'll be signs. There'll be signs. If you are one of the individuals that believes, the next day, what signs will show the rapture is near? If you're one of those that believes that the United States of America is the chosen people, Scripture does not say that. The chosen people are the people of Israel. Even in 2016, 17, 18, 19, 20, and so on, they will always be God's chosen people. So I lay this at your feet. As you learn, you will understand that the signs of the rapture drawing near will wrap around Israel. We are on the edge of all of this, but Israel is the key. And I've got to have you say it. Say, Israel's the key. It really and truly is. So in my study this week, David Jeremiah is a renowned pastor, author. He's got some pretty good stuff out there sometimes, and I found something that I like. He came up with 3, and really 4, and I'm adding one that I didn't add into your bulletin, about some of the signs that will happen as the rapture draws near. The first is the sign of deception. Many people will claim to be the Messiah and claim to have the answers for a troubled world. But Jesus says to take heed, literally to keep your eyes open so that we are not fooled. In the end times, people will be crying desperately for leaders to deliver them. And they will seek mystics and religious leaders who claim to have deeper knowledge. Back in 1973, there was a set of movies that came out. The first one was called A Thief in the Night. And it rocked the religious world. And it was a set of movies that talked about the end times. And when I first saw it, it shook me to the core. Especially the first one, A Thief in the Night. If you go to watch it now, it's hysterical. This girl that's the main character runs in the movie. And runs in the movie. And run. I calculated it up. The movie's 1 hour and 37 minutes. She ran 1 hour and 61 minutes. But the theme was about the rapture. Now, in 2000, Kirk Cameron, everybody says, yeah, you know him. Kirk Cameron came out with another brand new, a newer version of that type of a movie called Left Behind. Very well done. Very well done. And in those movies, we see deception at every angle, at every turn, and the leadership being placed and being moved by the evil forces. Deception will be a sign. There'll be more deception than there is now. This is why I keep telling you, men and women of the Word. Because guess what? Your wife might not be near you when the time comes to make that stand. Your husband, your son, your daughter, your mom, your dad, your granny, your grandpa, your sister, your brother might not be with you. And you might be saying, I get my strength from him or her. You've got to have your own strength and you've got to have your own understanding. Deception is coming. Deception will be unbelievable. The devil will deceive you. He is the deceiver. He is the king of deception. And when you think that you've got it all right, if you're not grounded. So some of the signs of deception. The second is the sign of disputes among nations. As wars and dissension among groups of people begin to escalate, we know it is a sign of Christ's return. The book of Revelation tells us the tribulation period is filled with war, ceaseless, unending, terrible war that will escalate until the world is involved. The Bible says that that as we move towards the end times, there will be constant talk of conflicts, border scrimmages, race wars, and national battles. In fact, it says wars and rumors of wars. World War II, for me, is history. I was not born. And for 85% of the people in here, it's history. We were not born. We who are sitting in here, many of us have gone through maybe the Korean War, Vietnam War, some of the conflicts that they have entitled, the Iraqi conflict, all of those. Folks, when we say world war, this time, it's not, Switzerland is not going to be able to sit out. It is going to be total consumption and everybody involved. And I want you to look what was written. There'll be constant talk of conflicts and border scrimmages. Are we hearing that now? There'll be constant talk of race. Folks, I'm just not talking yet about the United States. I'm talking about race wars in Africa and the Middle East. I'm talking about things that we need to become worldwide intelligent rather than state of West Virginia, Charleston, Nitro, Polka, Elkview, Clinton, I'm going on and on. We need to broaden our horizons and check what's going on because this is going to happen. And then when we say race wars, I'll be honest with you. I remember going to Dunbar Junior High as a seventh grader. The bus drops me off. Paul and I believe we're sitting side by side up in the stands. And all of a sudden, the biggest race fight I've ever seen in my life occurred on the gym floor. It was junior high. It was that day. It was that age. I've lived through terrible war of color. But folks, if we don't get a grip, if our country doesn't come and make some sort of rational relationship mending, we're heading to that again, and that plays into, in my opinion, us getting closer and the description of those things that are signs of the rapture coming. One that I don't have in your bulletin, write this down, the sign of devastation. And today, as you hear this, millions of people in the world are going hungry, even though God has blessed us with a fruitful, abundant planet. Don't understand that. As we get closer to the end times, there will be more and more famine. There will be earthquakes. And that's something that science says is happening now. Christ also spoke of pestilence, the spread of new diseases. And our world is experiencing a spike of tragic new diseases that we are unable to control. There's one thing happening, one after the other, after the other, after the other. You that are new moms and dads and have little ones, oh my, I pray for you. Because in the midst of everything else, diseases are changing. Things are happening. Be on the thought process of teaching your children Jesus and showing them that it's part of who you are. Devastation is rampant. Guys, I'm not going to stand in front of you and say there is or is not global warming. But I will tell you that there is a tremendous increase in humongous things happening in our world. Tsunamis, hurricanes, tornadoes, earthquakes, all of those things that quote unquote are natural. Who made natural? Nature was made by God. Devastation is a sign. And finally, the sign of deliverance into tribulation. Just before Jesus returns, there will be an explosion of antagonism towards God's people. Christians will be persecuted. We are seeing that happen today in the Middle East with ISIS. Horrific attacks. We are seeing that in Colombia. I could go over and name 15 countries that if you're a Christian, you are being persecuted. And some even to death. As we grow closer to the end, many will pay a high price for living out their faith in their world. Politically correct in the United States? Chuck it. Be biblically correct in all that you do for your lifetime. Amen. And God will bless you for it. Those are just some of the signs that will happen. Well, Pastor Mark, that doesn't help me get any closer to the date. I know it didn't help me either. It doesn't. Only thing that I'm trying to get you to see is that there are things that have to precede it. I said Israel is the key. You watch Israel. If America is ever on the side of the nations that attack Israel, we are doomed.
Amen.
Israel is the key. Always has been, always will be. So, what happens at the rapture? Pretty cool stuff, really. Pretty great stuff. And the very first thing is that Jesus Christ will come down from heaven in the sky. In fact, Scripture tells us, for the Lord himself will come down from heaven. All right, so what does that tell us? Heaven is up. Heaven is up. Whatever that means, heaven is up. Because Christ comes down from heaven. Now, does he come down to the earth? No, he does not. It's a major point here. He does not come down to the earth. He comes down into the sky, from heaven into the sky. And then there will be three loud commands which will announce the occasion. The Scripture tells us, with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and the trumpet call of God. Exciting. Exciting. All of this is going to be happening in a twinkling of an eye. Shorter than you can blink your eye. Everybody blink your eye. Blink your eye. It's quicker than that. It's faster than that. So Jesus comes, and these three commands, theologians cannot decide if these three sounds will be one after another or all at once. And what will that sound like for we, the believers? Max Lucado, one of the glorious, beautiful writers I've ever got the opportunity to read. Now, if you've never read a book by him, just pick one. He wrote these words, and I want you to listen. Have you ever wondered what the Lord's command will be? It will be the inaugural word of heaven. It will be the first audible message most have heard from God. It will be the word which closes one age and opens a new one. Then he writes, I think I know what that command will be. I could be very well wrong, but think the command which puts an end to the pains of the earth and initiates the joys of heaven will be two words. No more. The King of Kings will raise his pierced hand and proclaim, no more. No more loneliness. No more tears. No more death. No more sadness. No more pain. No more. I don't know what the sounds will be. I don't know what the words will be, but they will be magnificent to hear. Amen? And if you are one with God, you're going to hear it. Personally, I've always thought maybe it's come home. Come home. The time is now. Come home. You that have accepted my son, accepted me, it's Jesus in the cloud, the Lord's command, come home, my son. Come home, my daughter. Come on home. It doesn't get any better than coming home for the last time. Coming home. So, what happens immediately after these commands? The dead in Christ will rise first. And it says, and the dead will, in Christ will rise first. I've had people say, Pastor Mark, come on, man. What about the guy that died in 1421? And I say this, is our God not capable, who has already put together every molecule in existence, is he not capable of calling from nothingness almost, from dust, from all of those molecules back together, all the DNA back together, to produce that man or that woman thousands of years ago? Yes, he is. When I was a youth minister, we got into this one time. And in fact, Tony Nettle was teaching, and then it was awesome. And all of a sudden, a student said, okay, what about the man who gets burned up in a fire? God is a big God. What about the one that fell overboard, drowned, was eaten by a shark? The shark was eaten by a whale. The whale was eaten, but died, it rotted, and it all decayed. What about it? They started trying to put this and this and this and this together. Folks, it's all bad. Everybody go to this. That's all it is. It is God putting it all back together. The dead will be the first. We've had two recent funerals. And old Jim Bryan, Earl Meddings, going to be in that part. They're going to be there in a twinkling of an eye. They'll be popping out of their graves. They'll be, boom, gone. I know my mother will be there. Maybe your mom or dad or brother or sister or son or daughter, granny and grandpa. You know, bam, gone. Immediately. But then the alive in Christ will rise next. After that, who are still alive and left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. All right? It is simple. We are gone. That video depicts that man preaching, and he's rocking and rolling, and all of a sudden he says something, and bam, he drops his Bible, and out of that whole congregation, it looked like there was about, 15, 20 people left. Because immediately, we who are in Christ will leave this place. I don't care if those movies showed that I leave my clothes here, my shoes. You know, in all those movies, it's all neat. Have you noticed? Here's the shoes, and here's the clothes all folded up, and they're all looking good, and it's like you just left them, you know, pew. You know, guess what? I don't care what it looks like. I'm gone. Amen. You know, my clothes, whatever. I want you to understand that we will meet in the air. What a joyous reunion that'll be.
Amen.
Kim, you want to do that? You know? How about you, Chelsea? You know? Hunter, you ready to go? I mean, my question is, if it would happen right now, I'm gone. Are you? Twinkling of an eye. And then it says that we are with the Lord forever. It doesn't say that we're with the Lord for 10 minutes. It doesn't say that we're with the Lord for 122 years. It doesn't say that we're with the Lord for, 47 days and 16 minutes and 37 seconds. Forever. And I think we in our society can't grasp that. Don't want to grasp that. Won't grasp that. Forever. Dude, my father-in-law will be soon be 92. And we think that's old, right? We think that's ancient. When they get white hair and they start bending over and they walk like Tim Conway. You know, they walk like that. In our society, that's aging. But according to God, forever, folks. Forever. That's the rapture. Those are the events. But there's a couple other things I want to say. Because the rapture is not the second coming of Christ. It's not the second coming of Christ. The rapture will occur when Jesus returns for his church. This is where all true believers in Christ will be taken from earth into heaven. Okay? From earth into heaven. Christ does not come to earth. It's not the second coming. Now, I know that some of you all have been taught that the rapture is the second coming of Christ, and you wrap them together. And it's not correct, because he doesn't come to earth. He's in the air. So I want you to grasp that. It is where he comes and the church to take the church with him. Take is the key word here. Take the church with him. 1 Corinthians 15, listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. And that's just telling us that we that are here, boom, those that are dead will be changed. We will be changed in an instant. It is meeting him in the air. 1 Thessalonians 4. For the Lord himself, the one we read, will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and left caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. The Lord himself will come down from heaven, going to come down from heaven to into the sky. So, I put all that very quickly. The second coming of Jesus Christ will happen when Jesus returns with the church to defeat the Antichrist, overthrow evil, and then establish his thousand-year reign on earth. They're two totally different things. The rapture, he comes to take his church. The second coming, he brings his church to earth. And that's for the great battle of Armageddon. And I know Pat Harpole is not here today. And Pat Harpole, we love you, and if you see this tomorrow, yes, we know that you do not want to be on your horse, as it states in the scripture. And Pat, this is a message for you. You will be dressed in white. You will not, my lady, be serving coffee in the back corner of heaven. We all will be on horseback, and we all will be the army of God, and we all will come back to earth. And that's the second coming, Revelation 19. And I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and wages war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He's dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Coming out of his mouth is a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Description. Of Jesus Christ's second coming. The second coming is not the rapture. The rapture takes his church. Second coming brings the church back. So, let's discuss rapture practice. What are we supposed to be doing? How do we handle this information? I figured somebody would, and I figured it would be you, Kenny. So, rapture practice for us is, you know, when you really get there, it's very elementary. This is rapture practice. Okay? Because that's what it's going to be. But really, what should we be doing? Matthew 25 says this, and Jesus speaking in a parable. And a parable is that earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Grasp this. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. The bridegroom is Christ. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lights. And the foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet. And the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I don't know you." And Jesus says, "Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." Are you one of the 5 wise? Or the 5 foolish? If the rapture would come right now, are you ready? Let's pray. Father God, please give us 5 more minutes. That's all I ask of you. And from the depths of my soul, I plead for those 5 minutes. Because God, not everybody in this building knows your son Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. That's a fact. And I'm asking, oh God, I am begging, oh Lord, that you give them an opportunity now that they know that the rapture will come. And if they don't know you, they will be left behind. Let them be wise instead of foolish. Let them be saved instead of lost. Father God, please, God, I beg you, 5 minutes. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's children said,
amen.
Pastor Anthony, wherever you are, please come forward. Folks, these sermons are not to scare you. They are to educate you. These sermons are not to get you petrified. They are to awaken you to the point that you make wise decisions. It is imperative that before you leave today, that you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior and Lord. Not a scare tactic. Truth. And you might be saying, "Well, this is the first time I've ever been here." It doesn't matter. God's love is right now. It's to this point. It's immediate. So the question is, rapture occurs, are you gone or are you not? Are you wise or are you foolish? You're going to answer for yourself, and only God and you are going to know the answer in the next 5 minutes. Let's stand and sing. People who want Jesus, people who want to join the church, people who want saved, people who want to be baptized, people who need to pray, it's your time, right here, right now, right here, right now.